Well, today we wanted to talk about volatility, and specifically the volatility divergence between bonds and equities. So on your screen, we have the MOVE index, which is considered to be the bond VIX, and we plot that against the VIX, which is obviously the volatility gauge for equities. And there's this sharp divergence. You can see that the bond VIX has now moved up to levels last seen in March of 2020, which was a fairly catastrophic year, or catastrophic episode, I should say. And equity markets, you know, the volatility, the VIX index is well off of 2022 highs and certainly nowhere near that of March 2022. And this is something we actually touched on in our note this morning, our subscriber note. One is, if you just look at the prices of equity puts in general, what we have here is our 25 delta 30-day risk reversal. And all this is doing is looking at the price of call options relative to the price of put options. And it uses a 30-day rolling view, so we're always kind of measuring the same option in time. And what you can see is that we just came off of 2 days ago a period of relative calm in the markets. The S&P was pushing back to 4,600, and the call to put ratio, this sort of risk reversal measure, was saying, look, the market doesn't have any demand for puts right now. There's not much concern. Now, we've dropped 100 points since that time in the S&P, and this risk reversal metric has just slid down to roughly 8, as you can see here. Now, in the depths of sort of the Ukraine situation in February, we would touch down to this 14 area. As you can see, the real lows back to the March of 2020 sort of saga were down around 16. So this is real fear down in this area. And you can see that in this case, even though we dropped 2 or 3%, there's just not that real bid for puts in equity in the equity market. And you can see just below this risk reversal metric, we touched on this really interesting tidbit that IV Technicals put out on Twitter. And he mentioned that the 30-day straddle for the TLT, that's the U.S. long bond, government bond ETF, is now over that of SPDRs. So that syncs with this idea that there is a big divergence between the volatility in credit markets and the volatility in equities. So let's take another look at another chart that sort of displays this. So here what we've done is we plotted the history of the 30-day implied volatility. That's the 30-day implied options volatility of TLT in blue versus that of SPDRs in orange. And what you can see here, as mentioned in that note, is at this time, the TLT, which is the blue line again, is above that of SPDRs. Now, typically there's a pretty good correlation between volatility in these two asset classes. You can see here, there's a big spike in August of 2015, between the two of them. There's a big spike, obviously, in March of 2020, and then some of these other episodes throughout time. Now, what often happens in sell-offs, in equity market sell-offs, when there's high risk, is traders will sell equities and they will look for the security of the risk-free government bonds, right? And so a lot of times this volatility that you're seeing corresponds with people flooding into the TLT or long bonds because they're looking for protection. And so that is certainly what a lot of the volatility, this blue line higher in March of 2020 was, as well as some of these other episodes. And then you'll note there's a couple other divergences here. Typically what that is after a bout or a round of fear, equity volatility will drop really hard, and then that will leave the long bond volatility just a little bit higher. That's kind of what a lot of these divergences are. But this here is something different. This is a build in credit market TLT volatility, and it corresponds with a small build, obviously, in equity market volatility. But over the last few weeks, we've gotten equity market volatility subsiding, but the TLT long bond, which is obviously the most sensitive government bond to interest rates, you're seeing that volatility continue to go higher. So again, this syncs with the idea of the MOVE index moving up or shifting higher and the VIX not responding in the same way. So we wanted to show this, the price of these two instruments relative to each other, to help display exactly what we're talking about. As you can see, with kind of big sell-offs in the equity market, let me just flag a few of these, what you see obviously is a corresponding jump in the price of TLT. This is, again, a flight to safety. If you think about the idea of the 60-40 portfolio, right? People hold or own bonds as a way to offset the risk in their equity portfolio. And in this case, when things get really scary in the equity market, you look for a little bit more of a bond allocation. And then after the fear subsides, once off typically happens, the Fed will come out and say, hey, we got your back. The Fed put is in place. people will sell those bonds and they buy back equities. And so you see this, and this corresponds to that spike in volatility with TLT often is that it's almost like a spike because people are driving in to buy. There's so much demand to get in because of the fear trade, and then the volatility will come back down as the fear subsides and traders go back into equities. So you can see that was generally what the correlation is. However, what is happening here is a little bit different. In this case, we have equity markets selling off in a much bigger relative sell-off in TLT, in the government bonds. And so the correlation of these two is flipping a little bit. There was some bouts of this situation wherein people were feeling like during the COVID crash that bonds were not acting as an effective hedge for equity portfolios. And there was a lot of talk about the fact that, look, if you really wanted to hedge this volatility, you're going to have to buy an actual volatility, right? You're going to have to buy likely something like VIX futures, own put options in equities or something of the sort. So this is a unique divergence here, this fact that equities are coming down and long bonds in particular are selling off hard. Now you're getting the 10 years selling down, et cetera, and there's not a good time frame for when this is going to end, right? There doesn't seem to be clarity on how many rate changes we're expecting, what's inflation going to do. You got midterms coming up, and there's just not a clear path to resolve this volatility. And so what's really the big deal about that? Well, one of the most popular strategies for funds is this idea of risk parity or vol targeting. So if you think about Bridgewater, biggest hedge fund in the world, there's a lot of other very large funds. They model strategies or they run strategies that are based on this general model of targeting volatility. So how much volatility exists in bonds and various currencies or commodities and equities, and they target a certain amount of volatility based on historical factors. I'm making some generalizations here just to prove the point, but on your screen is the risk parity ETF. Now this risk parity ETF could use some different strategies, obviously, like Bridgewater or something of that sort, but the point is going to be the same. You can see that this strategy started, or this ETF rather, launched just before the COVID crash. And in general, it's performed with equities, even outperforming equities a little bit over the last 2 years. And what you can see is this divergence. And this is almost exactly like the inverse of the move and VIX divergence, right? In this case here, though, we have the risk parity fund dropping or strategy dropping with equities kind of popping over the last few weeks. And this is a result of that bond market volatility. When that bond market volatility is too high, they have to get out of bonds to reduce their exposure to that asset class. That causes some losses and some deleveraging, et cetera. So when a lot of strategies are tied to the fact or are based on the fact that credit market and bond volatility should be lower or is historically lower than what we're seeing now, that causes issues with a lot of these strategies. And you can see, again, this is a clear divergence, something that we arguably haven't seen over the past. And that again, is anecdotal, but this really explains sort of what sort of the risk is in terms of flows coming into and out of the market. We would also note that if you just look at a divergence in equities themselves, you get another part of the picture. In this case, the S&P is well diversified, right? You have exposure to some commodities, defensive, you know, cyclicals, all sorts of different stocks in the S&P 500 that could offer you some protection in this changing macro environment. Whereas in the Qs, you have a much more interest rate sensitive set of stocks. And that outperformance or that divergence is really seen pretty clearly in here. So there is some argument that, look, the reason that the VIX isn't quite as high is simply the fact that the S&P is receiving money and there's some sector rotation, but on net, that is keeping the S&P up fairly well. But in this case, you have a situation where tech is clearly underperforming. So that is, again, part of the fact that the interest rates are shooting higher. Now, obviously, the biggest components of the S&P 500 are all tech stocks. And so when you have that, they're all core components of the Qs. Eventually, you're going to get high correlation if there is a strong enough sell-off. So let's talk about what we think that means for equities. Well, this point here is where the Fed Brainard came out and said that they may be more aggressive with the rate hikes, and that has caused a major decline in equities. We lost, you know, about a little over 100 points, 100 handles, right, in the S&P. And that put us back into this sort of very neutral to negative gamma point. We're using 4,500 as our gamma flip level. There's a big bunch of open interest at this level, and it's below this vol trigger line wherein we see high volatility in the market. And that is led by an increase in implied volatility and a pickup in negative gamma. And we have a bunch of other videos that discusses these dynamics. But the point here is that we have fairly muted demand for put options. We have a VIX that just does not seem to want to move higher in correlation with that larger bond volatility. And we think that the equity market is really going to need to kind of catch up to that. Because again, if we go back to this first chart we were looking at, and you say, look, the credit market is much larger than the equity market. It's screaming about volatility and uncertainty. And there can be certain flows that are out going out of the bond market, obviously, and into equities. But the fact that this continues to shift higher with a low demand of puts, with volatility not really spiking, I think this is a flag, a divergence that isn't making a lot of sense. And these two, we believe, need to sort of shift together. And we think that the way that this is going to rectify itself is likely a sell-off or drawdown in equities. And then eventually we'll get some sort of resolution on the interest rate side where people can start to forecast and better understand, look, here's our expectations. It's going to be 3, 4, 5, 6 hikes, whatever it may be. But there's clarity here and we can start to model and forecast the future, right? Because right now you just can't really do that given not just the Fed, but also the inflation and geopolitical situation. So we'll continue to be writing about this in our daily subscriber notes. If you're interested in trying that out, please go to spotgamma.com and you get a 7-day free trial. If you have any questions, please put them in the comment section below or hit us up at SpotGamma on Twitter. Thanks.